But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body.
So while they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling white clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified, and they bowed their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He's not here, but is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified and on the third day rise again?"
Then they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all of this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now, it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them like an idle tale, and they did not believe them.
But Peter got up and ran to the tomb, and stooping and looking in, he saw the linen clothes all by themselves. Then he went home amazed at what had happened. My friends, this is the good news, that the grave is empty. Christ is risen.
Hallelujah.
This is the good news. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never put it out.
Hallelujah.
This is the good news. Once we were no people, now we are God's people.
Hallelujah.
Christ is our peace, the indestructible peace we now share with each other. He is risen.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen indeed.
Thank you. victors, people singing, Alleluia. Where, O death, is now thy sting? Alleluia. Dying once, Christ lives to save. Alleluia. Where your victory, O grave, Alleluia. Love's redeeming work is done. Alleluia. But the fight, the battle won. Alleluia. Death is paid for his price. Oh, Alleluia. God has opened paradise.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Won't you turn to your neighbors right and left and offer them a sign of peace and offer these musicians a wonderful, wonderful round of applause. Oh, what a great pleasure to welcome all of you. Before we continue our worship with the wonderful choirs, I wanted to just add a word of welcome to all of you who may be visitors and guests to Union Church this first day. This is a wonderful church that has lots more going on than just Easter. The joy and the grace and the peace and the hard work that goes on here is a delight all year round. And so we hope that you might join us some other time if you'd like to. It's not usually as crowded, so you're always welcome. Right after church, we invite you to linger if you're able. There's some hot crust buns in the parlor that are right behind us. And if you're able to stay, we'd love to share some time with you if you'd like to. I know lots of you have wonderful Easter things to do, so I hope that you'll enjoy the company however long you can stay. I wanted to invite you to just to join me in a couple prayers. We have some folks in our midst who we're thinking of very importantly today. We have several folks who are ill and in this hospital. And so as the music rolls over us, as the life lifts within us, I hope that you will lift your prayers with us for Myrna Davis, who's was having gallbladder complications. We're remembering Marlene Payne, who's at home, and we hope watching on the web tonight, or this morning. And Kelly Ambrose as well. You can wave at the camera if everybody likes to. You can back there. Also, Les Pross had to go to the hospital, a dear friend of the congregation. He's at St. Joe, Maine with an intestinal blockage, but doing okay so far, so fingers crossed with that. And special prayers for Judith Singleton's family. Her sister is gravely ill, so we're thinking of her as well. And whatever problems, burdens, sorrows, and delights, joys, and strengths that have come in with you this day, may this room contain them, but may God's hand hold them. We hope that all will be at peace as we worship today. This is the great day of the church. It is great to celebrate with each and every one of you.
Our Hebrew scripture lesson today comes from Isaiah 65, 17 through 25. For I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind. Be glad and rejoice forever in what I am creating, for I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it, or the cry of distress. No more shall there be in it an infant that lives but a few days, or an old person who does not live out a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 years will be considered a youth, and one who falls short of 100 will be considered accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For like the days of a tree shall the days of my people be, and my chosen shall long enjoy the works of their hands. They shall not labor in vain or bear children for calamity, for they shall be offspring blessed by the Lord, and their descendants as well. Before they call, I will answer. While they are yet speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox. But the serpent's, its food shall be dust. They shall not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. Amen.
Now I invite our young and young at heart to come on up and let us see what it is, what we are talking about today. Come over toward these stairwells, and if those of you in the front rows can help us get the stools up too. You guys, there's lots of room on this side.
Plenty of room.
Plenty of room. What a delight it is to see all of you. I am so excited to see you. This is a very fabulous day today. What are we celebrating?
Easter!
Easter! Yes, yes, Easter. Easter is such a special day. What is it about Jesus that we're celebrating today? Yes.
Getting Easter baskets.
Getting Easter baskets. Haha, close, but no cigar.
Yeah. Jesus rose from the dead, right? So Jesus, people were really upset with Jesus, right? Because he was doing things that made them feel uncomfortable and telling them to love people that they were uncomfortable about loving, right? And they got so upset that what happened? He died. Yeah, they killed him. But here's what's amazing. He didn't stay dead. Right? Isn't that amazing?
A little amazing.
Yeah.
It's a little amazing, right? A little amazing. It's
a miracle, in fact. It is so amazing. It is a miracle. Yes. He went into a tomb, which is where they put the bodies of people who died, right? He went into a tomb, and they put him there. And when you put something somewhere, you expect it to stay there, right? Mm-hmm. Did Jesus stay there?
No.
No. No. That morning, the women came to the tomb, and they saw that someone had opened the door. And what was inside? Nothing.
Nothing.
Nothing. It was amazing.
Except, tomb robbers.
Except his sheets.
Except his sheets. Yes. Yeah. He made his bed, actually, before he left. It's very important to remember that. So then, what happened to him? Did we ever see him again? We do. We do. Jesus comes back to say, look, death was not the end. The end is bigger than you could imagine. The end is resurrection. The end is new life, like the prophet Isaiah was saying. New life. Now, we have a symbol that we use to talk about this. Do you see a lot of something in this room?
People.
People, a lot
yes.
Of people.
And we are so glad there are so many people.
Butterflies and balloons.
Butterflies and balloons, yes. And love. Yes, we see a lot of love. The answer is almost always love. This time, though, it's butterflies. Yes. Yes, butterflies. So, we have these, oops. These guys. Now, who knows how you become a butterfly?
I don't know.
Yeah.
They turn into a cocoon, and then they
You're right. Yeah, so they start out as a what?
Caterpillar.
Look, Reverend Kent has a caterpillar. You're right, actually. They start out as eggs, and then they become a caterpillar. And they eat and eat and eat. I bet some of you have read that book, right?
And then they come out like a cocoon.
Yes, and they make a cocoon, and we think of the cocoon as like the tomb, right? So you've got Jesus the caterpillar, and then he goes into the tomb, and then what comes out? Right. New life, which we symbolize with a butterfly because it's like coming out of a cocoon. So,
it has two lives.
Yes. There's an old one and a new one. And that's what we celebrate at Easter. Yeah, sometimes they have to rest a little bit because it's hard to do all that. Yeah. Yes. All right. So
when transformation happens like that, it can be kind of scary. I mean, I don't know how. I mean, it's all pretty to us, but to the butterfly, to the caterpillar, it may be a little weird. But that's a reminder for us too, right? Because we know that as people of faith, sometimes we have to do scary things. Sometimes you may be not sure you can do something, and the butterfly is also a reminder that you got more power than just your own. If you interviewed 100 caterpillars, how many of them would raise their 20 arms and say, "Yes, yes, I could become a butterfly"? None of them would say that because they don't even know. And yet, there is a power greater than ours, right? And they can't talk? What? Caterpillars can totally talk. What?
They can talk to each other.
It's so right. Transformation sometimes doesn't, we never know when it might happen. Sometimes death is a transformation. We believe even then we transform into new life, right? Yeah. So today we're going to give a symbol of these new life, a little butterfly for everybody to have. So you have to make a promise. Raise your right hand. I solemnly swear. I will not poke my brother or my sister. I will not swat anyone at all over the head with my butterfly. Because this is a sign of new life. And I really want it to be a living, loving symbol. Not a symbol of hurt and pain. Excellent. Oh, you're so wonderful, Easter. This is a great Easter. You all are wonderful.
Yes.
Absolutely. Well, we want you
to pray first.
Let's have a prayer and then we'll pass out our butterflies, okay? After the prayer.
What do you all want to pray for today? Yeah. I couldn't quite hear you, but I know.
Dogs communicate by barking.
Oh, okay.
So we are giving praise
all
God's creatures.
Praise for dogs and ways that caterpillars Amen. Communicate and all of those things.
Amen.
Yes.
What else should we pray for? Yeah. And it grew.
Yeah,
things grow
they
fast.
Grow so fast.
Things grow fast. Well, prayers
yeah,
for good growth.
God.
Amen. Let us pray for God.
We are thankful for God today.
Amen.
Yes, indeed. Yeah.
Pink.
Pray for pink?
Yes. All right.
Okay. We got a lot of it here.
All the beautiful colors of this world. Amen. Yes. All right. Well, let's pray together. Now, remember, a couple of us in here, remember the pretzel prayer? Well, you can pray like this if you want to. Right, you can pray pretzel prayer, you can pray hands folded prayer, you can pray eyes wide open prayer, however is prayerful for you, and however is joyful. Let's pray.
God, thank you for leading us through the cocoon and into butterfly land. Thank you for the ways that you, through Jesus, showed us new life, showed us your love that conquers all, and help us when we feel like we are in cocoons to remember that you are doing amazing things with us and that we are becoming butterflies. God, we ask that you put your loving hands on all the caterpillars and all the dogs and all the creatures as they communicate with each other and they live and breathe and bring us so much joy and you so much joy in your creation. We pray for all the colors of the world, for the pinks and the blues and the purples and all the things that make us so happy. And God, we give you thanks for being our God, for showing us that your love is always overpowering everything. We love you, God, and on Easter especially, we say thank you, and together we say,
Amen. Thanks, you guys. We'll pass them out.
Gently.
Here we go. Got one? Here's another one. Sorry.
I missed up what you meant there.
Each week we've been singing the Psalms and with a different response, and today's response is special. It's we're going to sing it both in Latin and in English. So for those nerds in the audience, you get your take. If you'd like to follow along, in the Psalm is there'll be a little R in the text on page 700 of the black hymnals. And if you're in the balcony, you will have found the black hymnals at the top of the stairs, I hope, and you can follow right along. Otherwise, the choir will indicate. Now this response, we're going to sing it first in Latin and then go back each time and sing it in English. At the end of the psalm, it's a round, so I will help lead you and you can come in anywhere you want. And if you are not a round person, if you are perhaps a square person, if you are not certain you would like to sing, then your job is to tap your toe, smile brilliantly, and nod in time as your neighbor sings very loudly next to you. We are at play in the fields of the Lord. This day we celebrate and rejoice. Jubilate Deo means celebrate God.
Jubilate Deo, Jubilate Deo, Alleluia. In the Lord rejoicing, Christ is risen from the dead. Alleluia.
Oh, give thanks to God, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever. Let all Israel say, God's steadfast love endures forever. God is my strength. God has become my salvation.
rejoicing, Christ is risen from the dead. Alleluia. Jubilate Deo, jubilate Deo, jubilate Deo. Alleluia. 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 Amen. Hear now this reading from the book of Acts. Peter began to speak to them and said, I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses both what he did in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people, and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Here ends the reading of our scripture. Would you pray with me as we begin our meditation together? Lord, your word rises within us, and we trust and pray that it will not return to you empty. Grant that what we speak, what we think, what we hope, what we yearn, what we act on, what we do, and how we receive the actions of others might reflect the light that you send us this Easter morning. Grant that we might see with Easter eyes all that you place before us. This we ask in the risen Christ's name. And the people said, Amen. Why do you look for the living among the dead? This is the question that these strange angels ask the women who arrive at the tomb. Why are you looking for the living among the dead? What do you expect to find in a graveyard? Nothing but dust and bodies and broken headstones. So why come here if what you seek is Jesus the Christ? Now, it's an odd question coming from messengers who clearly must know what's gone on for the women. These are the same women, by the way, that Luke mentions as having supported Jesus' ministry from the beginnings in Galilee all the way to the bitter end in Jerusalem. There is sad irony that they were the first ones to put their money where their heart was, but it's Peter and the disciples who don't believe them and think, oh, it's an idle tale told by just women. Just women who just showed up and just paid for everything and just made it possible for just people to be just healed. Just that is all. These same idle tale tellers were the same ones who baked the bread and sat at the feet of Jesus and welcomed the strangers and fed the disciples and nursed their wounds after all the times when it didn't go so well out in the fields. Why have you come looking here? The messengers ask these women who are faithful to the very, very, very end. After the disappointments of the Monday, Thursday, after the betrayal, after Good Friday and nails on a cross, even then they show up. They show up. They show up to do what is necessary and what is done. Now, I submit to you that in a way, this is seeking the living. That what they were doing was, in fact, acting in life, the very life-giving hope that they had been taught. Now, they didn't come with hope to the tomb. I think they came just to pay their last respects, to put that final period on the sentence of Jesus' ministry and life, to give a blessing. Remember, it was Mary who broke a jar of ointment and poured it all over the feet of Jesus, ointment saved for his burial, and maybe they had gathered spices now to just say the final farewell. When they arrive, however, they arrive not to death. They arrive to confusion. Confusion is the first part of getting organized. I don't know if you know that. I had a great pastoral care provider when I was back at the University of Chicago, long, 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 long ago. And she said that one of the greatest gifts that you can give yourself is confusion. Mm. Now, as a person who has spent years, decades even, trying to get out of being confused, this was not necessarily welcome news to me. It may not be to you. But here's her point. Confusion scrambles all of our preconceived notions. Confusion allows us to let go not only of the things that we want to understand, but let go of the ways we have mistakenly understood the world. We all have a construct in our head of the way things are supposed to be, and when we start to act on that, rather than on the way the world is actually treating us, we can find great pain, we can cause great distress, we can be a part of great destruction. We've decided that the world works one way, and despite the world telling us, or perhaps the opportunity offered us to think or act differently, we refuse confusion, we welcome certainty, and we crush the future. The women come confused. Grave robber, maybe? Someone stole the body? Maybe there's worse to come than we thought. We thought this was all over and we were just going to go home to Galilee. Maybe we need to run. Maybe we need to get some protection. And then the men who say, no, 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 it's not that. He rose from the dead. So it's so much simpler now. The gift of confusion is the gift to see that which you could not see before, the possibility that suddenly opens up. And for the women, here they are, opened against perhaps even their will to this new possibility of new life. Confusion is the start of nearly every good project that gets you organized. Where are you going to go to school? There's so many brochures. How do I begin? What kind of job will I take, get, have? What will I do in retirement? I'm confused about whether I want to keep working or if I want to travel. Fine. These are the small examples. Then there's the worst ones, the ones that trouble us every day. Because the tombs that we sit in are perhaps just as dark and deep. The tombs of what will happen if I quit my job? What will happen if I stay or leave this relationship? What if I get better and nobody notices? What if I get worse and nobody cares? All of these are the tombs that we sit in, all of these. And the confusion is our spark. Easter, I think, was meant to be confusing. Confusing to the early church, confusing to us. Shake up your preconceived notions. Those of you who have come decided as well-meaning and good-minded post-Christians like myself, I'm post-Christian. I'm not sure what that means either. But those who have thought, my faith does not depend on a resurrection, a bodily resurrection. My faith doesn't necessarily need that. And yet, I hold a little part of my brain that says, but what did those early disciples see that transformed this world from a caterpillar of tangled hopes to a church with wings? And for those who have been dyed in the wool to believe that the bodily resurrection is the only way to understand, what do we do about the possibility that maybe maybe this is just a metaphor, but not just a metaphor, kind of like just those women who just healed just everybody. Maybe it's just a metaphor, but a metaphor that has the power to break death. The power to break the hold of death on all of our lives. It's worth being a little confused. It's worth wondering just if. In the scripture that Jack read from Isaiah, it says, I will so transform this world that none shall hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain. And to do that, every creature in all creation had to learn to see differently. You'll notice in that passage, which we're very fond of quoting at various times, that the lion lays down with the lamb. And the lion learns to eat straw like the ox. It means that those who are used to bloodshed and killing have to learn a different way. They have to see creation differently if none will hurt or destroy on the holy mountain. And this, for carnivores, is a little confusing. But it is also the promised peace and life. It is also the promised peace in life. The disorganization of our worries, of our furors, perhaps of our despairs, the disorganization of our hearts and mind is not left so. But rather, it is the love of Christ that organizes that, sweeps up the pieces of our broken hopes, and gathers them together, pulling them into the new reality, pieces rearranged to see differently. I remember that great story that's so timely still. Guess who's coming to dinner? You remember Sidney Poitier and Katharine Hepburn in this? And the wonderful San Francisco judge and his upper socialite wife, and they discover that their daughter is bringing home a fiancé, only he comes and he's African-American. He's black, and this is the 60s, and they're progressive, but wow, this is interesting. Wow, what are we going to do now? Because this is really going to be hard to explain to all our socialite people. And then, of course, the black family comes and they're like, how are we going to explain all these white folks to our church? What organizes the ultimate end of that story is love. The recognition that beyond skin color and class differences, there are beating hearts of hope. There is grace that abounds. And in your life, maybe in mine, certainly, beyond depressions, beyond angers and failures, beyond the things that break open your very soul, there is life that has gone ahead of you to Galilee. It's gone ahead of you, maybe just two steps are you behind it. Why do we look for the living among the dead? Because that's where we are a lot of days. Why do we look for the living among the shards of this earth? Because we have been broken into a million pieces and put back together and broken again some days. Hosea says, the Lord has made us, shattered us, and on the third day will reunite us. And so it is. We may be only shards of this coming kingdom, this one Hohana, this family of faith. We may be only broken pieces with our hearts fumbling toward that which we most hope for and only guessing at what we want or need or can do or can give. But we are not without hope. We are not left behind with the discarded clothes. God is always mucking around in that which is dead and lifeless to bring up hope and love, always. Where does Jesus spend his time? With the rich? With the people who had enough to eat? Did Jesus spend his time with the people who were already well and healed? Where does Jesus go? Jesus goes to the downtrodden and the beaten up, and the bloodied, and the worried, and the sad, and the sorrowful, and the discounted, and the discarded. Jesus goes there because life is among the dead. Ezekiel preaches to a valley of dry bones, and they rattle to life. Somebody in this room is a bag of dry bones on the inside right now, and you can't tell. Somebody in this room came hopeless and wasn't sure why they got dragged here this morning. And I'll tell you the answer. The answer is that 300 people came to remind you that your bones will knit together, and the breath of God is for you and blows to you and for you. 300 people came to remind you that even if it is just a metaphor, the living are already among the dead, and the signs of new life are already among us and bursting forth. And that as we grow and as we live and as we see as Easter people with Easter eyes, so then we drop the shrouds of all that binds us and all that kills us and all that worries this world. Sexism dead, but the people alive. White privilege and all of its toxic effects and the way we kill each other, let it die and seek the living hearts beneath it. Those who have nothing, who see no future, who no one will give a job to, let them see your outstretched hand. And let Easter begin with that. As Christ sought the living among the dead, and as Christ died, and so we die, and so we raised up with Christ's resurrection, so we ought to find some way to follow through and offer even the tiniest breath of hope. Because contained in every gesture of grace and love, yours, no, yours, the seeds of Easter are planted all over again. To your enemies, your kindness will be as confusing as anything said to the women at the tomb. To those who love you, your generosity will never fail to be an inspiration and may guide this world to somewhere it has yearned to be. In those words from Isaiah, that place where all are fed and none are hurt, in that place where the shroud is taken away, when God is doing a new thing with all of us, don't we need it? I saw this wonderful headline from The Onion. You familiar with The Onion? That great tome of the American gospel? A satirical newspaper, The Onion, showed a picture of an SUV with an open back door and a well-clad young man walking down the street with two lab technicians behind him with clipboards. And the headline was, "Scientists release average untroubled normal Americans back into the wild in the hopes of establishing a sustainable population." It does seem that way, doesn't it? You can watch the news and you can think there is nothing but sadness or sorrow in this world. You can listen to the radio and think only of those who have been killed and had their lives taken by the rage and fury of others. And this we should think about. We should not pass over it in some glaze of alleluia hysteria. We should not pretend that because we have hope that we cannot see evil and do not know heartbreak. It's the opposite. Because we have hope, we have the courage to hold heartbreak in our hands. Because we know a risen Christ, we need not fear, and we can confront the powers of this world that are meant to destroy and take life and liberty and well-being. No, we have a lot of experience standing among what looks to be dead and proclaiming life. Why then do you stand among the dead looking for the dead? Why then have you flogged the old and no longer rideable horses of your own spirit. Why then do you speak, hoping just to be ignored? Truly, I tell you, friends, seek the living among the dead. Find that which gives life even among the shattered pieces. Look for that which is a sign of life and growth to you, and nurture it. Don't clench too tightly, but neither should you let go. The living walk among us. Those who have found light and love contain and show forth the seeds of this resurrection all day long, every day of the week. There is nowhere you can run. There is no place you can flee where God's love will not seek you, find you, lift you, hold you, and change your life forever. And confuse you. Did I mention confusion? Confusion may be our lot, but it's not a bad place to start. It is better to go in with what the Buddhists call beginner mind. Forget what you think you know. Enter into this life looking for life. Enter into this love loving. Go out. Go from this place. Get out. Get out of your Easter clothes. Put down all the Easter dishes. Figure out what is next for you, where there is life, and go there. And just see if the risen and living one hasn't gotten there ahead of you to prepare a place. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Amen.
We give our gifts in celebration and in hope. We give them to walk ahead of us, to seek the living among the dead. We give them because we have been given them. And so let us share in these gifts today.
Please be seated. Before we leave this place, let us linger in the joy and silence of prayer. It is nothing to have 300 people make a raucous noise. It is everything to find just a moment of release as we all listen to the breaths of the hearts and minds around us. Let us hold our neighbor's well-being in our hearts. Let us look to the world with a risen eye. And let us allow those burdens we carry to be lifted and those burdens of others to be held more gently as we fall silent in God's presence, knowing we're always in God's presence, but more aware of it here and now. Let us pray.
As we pray, we lift our prayers for those who have come here today as strangers and guests to this congregation. We pray that God's people may sustain them, that God's words may inspire us together, and that the love of a risen and rising Jesus be shown to all. Lord Jesus, here are your disciples. We meet you even in the midst of confusion. Help us live into those questions for which there are no easy answers. Feed our faith with the assurance of your presence. May we hear your voice in and through all the other voices we hear. May we find life even in your questions.
Blossom even in our uncertainty.
Lord Jesus, here are your disciples. We meet you even amidst the tombs and stony places. Bring new life where we are worn and tired. Bring new love where we have turned hard-hearted. Bring forgiveness where we feel hurt and where we have wounded others. Bring joy and release where we are prisoners of ourselves.
May we let go of fear and embrace hope. Heal our broken places that we may share your resurrection joy.
Lord Jesus, here are your disciples, the body of Christ. Your church. We pray for your church throughout the world and for that part to which we belong, that we may find both wisdom and strength to be your hands of mercy, of compassion, and right relation. Help us rise free of all that binds us, of all that divides us from one another. May we be liberated and united by the love of the resurrected one. Eternal Spirit, Earth Maker, Pain Bearer, Life Giver, Source of all that is and all that shall be, Father and Mother of us all, loving God in whom is heaven, the hallowing of your name echo through the universe, the way of your justice be followed by peoples of the world, your heavenly will be done by all created things. Your commonwealth of peace and freedom sustain our hope and come on earth. With the bread we need for today, feed us. In the hurts we absorb from one another, forgive us. In times of temptation and test, strengthen us. From trials too great to endure, spare us. From the grip from all that is evil, free us. For you reign in the glory and the power that is love, now and forever. Amen.
Our closing hymn will be number 245, and those of you who wish to join the Hallelujah Chorus at the end, we invite you to make your way on the last verse, make your way up to join the choir and band. You may find it easier to go up the back stairs so that you don't run over the trumpets and the tuba up here. Also, my friends, for those, it's tradition, of course, to stand for the Hallelujah Chorus, but if at any point you find that difficult to do, you are welcome to simply stand inside yourself, seated as you would like to be. Won't you rise if you would like to and sing with us number 245? Ah, the quiet murmurings of the faithful as they gather. As the choir assembles itself, do this with me. Turn to someone next to you and just beam at them. Flash your pearly whites. It is a sad fact sometimes of American worship that when we sing, we look as though we are standing in the grave, and I wanted to see you, I wanted to see the living among the dead. Now say this to the person you're looking at least one person. You are beloved of God. Say it with me. You are beloved of God. You are a spirit rising. The power of Christ is in this world.
The power of Christ is in this world.
And the power of love sustains us all.
The power of love sustains us all.
My friends, this day, whether you go from here across the street or all the way to Galilee, may that love fly before you, paving the way with graces. And may you in your own travels, may you in your own journeys and destinies, may you go living words. Go, be alive among the dead, knowing that Christ lifts, raises, and loves through you all. And the people said, Amen. Amen. Hallelujah, my friends. Hallelujah.